absolutely a lot of familiar faces, and a few that I haven't seen before, as I'm being told by our photographer to move back to. It's a rather particular pleasure to be able to welcome back Julia Clare Robinson, who is, as far as British Pugwash is concerned, was the father of this whole sphere of our activity. And it's very good that he's still around and taking an active interest in what the younger generation is now up to. The decision to invite Richard Guthrie to join the executive committee was taken when we knew that he was going to be out of the country a lot of the time in Syria, and indeed that was right, we didn't see very much of him for quite some time. However, he's now back, and he is one of the two of our speakers today who will be coming with dusting the chemical dust off his shoes and telling us about exactly how it was, and particularly the misleading narratives that have been told subsequently on the subject. And then he will be followed by Caitriona McLeish, who's been a member of the executive committee for slightly longer, who will be telling us her particular slant on it through the After Sussex programme. And we've brought the two together and given each of them a chance to tell us what they've been up to recently. So we'll then be open to general discussion, which I'm much looking forward to hearing. So, Richard, lead off.
Thank you very much. Just to clarify, I was overseas in relation to Syria and chemical weapons, but I will be discreet about where I might have been at a particular moment. We'll do this as a two-hander. I'll give a quick introduction of actually what it is we know. You know, some sort of fairly cold, hard facts or what has been clearly reported. Caitriona will do the competing narratives part, and then I'll discuss ongoing consequences, try and wrap up the to an end, and then we go into questions and answers. First of all, I want to just say something that's very particular about the Middle East. There is something very odd about the region, and it's not simply Arab-Israeli conflict, which is what normally comes up when immediately you discuss the Middle East. Now, how you count chemical weapons can be done in a variety of ways. It can be counted by the amount of the agent used, it can be counted by the individual munitions. Depending on which method you use, it's certainly much less than 5%, possibly less than 1%, of all the manufactured chemical weapons in the world were manufactured in the Middle East. And yet, all of the credible allegations of a proper use of chemical weapons since the Second World War have been in the Middle East region. And I think that is very interesting of itself. We've got the cases in Yemen in 1963 and 67, which I'll touch upon again in a minute. Iraq versus Iran, through a number of years of the Iran-Iraq war, and the Iraqi use within Iraqi Kurdistan. And then we've got the situation in Syria. So the Middle East somehow has a special characteristic, and I'll return to that. So what do we know before the crisis that's happened within Syria since 2011? Well, it was pretty clear that Syria had a chemical weapons program of some sort. If you look at what its geopolitical situation, there were significant pressures that were very overt, very transparent, for them to have a form of a program to be able to respond both to Israeli nuclear potential and the fact that Israel had a significantly stronger conventional forces. And you've got to remember that Syria had essentially been defeated both in 67 and 73, and in 82 in the invasion of Lebanon, and also found itself in a very weak position. But it was unclear what the scale of those activities were. We knew they had something, but was it simply a research program? Was it production? Or was it connected with other people's programs? I'm just going to dwell slightly on that because there's a lot of the history of the Syrian program that's forgotten. This is James Defence Weekly from the 2nd of April in 1988. This article, people said there was very little ever written about it in the public record, but actually there was quite a lot. I've just chosen this as an example simply because of this chap, Vladimir Pikulov, who was the head of the Soviet chemical weapons forces. He was, the chemical weapons troops. He pops up in Damascus, and I'm just going to talk you through just to show that there was, at least the Soviets at the time thought there was a chemical weapons program. It's a relatively routine article. There's a couple of the Phibis pieces, the Foreign Broadcast Information Service, just about him being there. But I want you just to think about that date, 23rd of March, 88. Now, as a date, that probably doesn't jump out, but if I tell you the attack on Halabja, the Kurdish village, happened on the 16th of March, 1988, and suddenly the chap who's rumoured, or with very good evidence, to be the international liaison for the Soviets on chemical weapons cooperation, pops into Damascus on a high-profile visit, that tells you something. Now, there's all sorts of rumours about what he was doing, precisely, but to me is the very clearest indication that at the time Syria had an active program, and Pikulov was the liaison point on the Soviet side. And there was other things, this is their official news agency, so they weren't hiding the fact Pikulov had made a southern visit, but it just illustrates that there were those connections. The Syrian chemical weapons program appears to start soon after the defeat of the 73 war with Israel. Now this is where Yemen becomes significant. I want people to think back to 1967. In January 67, the Egyptian-backed Republican forces in the Yemen civil war were backed into a corner in one battle. The Egyptian Air Force used chemical weapons against the Saudi-backed royalist forces, and these were seen as having had some success in the battle. Because later, the Saudis were prepared at that point to make a formal complaint to the UN Security Council. They prepared the paperwork to do so. Because middle of 67, there's the Arab-Israeli war. The Arab side is heavily defeated. The Egyptians start to say to their Arab colleagues, chemical weapons could be very useful on the battlefield. It brings an end, this need for Arab unity brings an end to the Yemen civil war. But it seems that a number of countries don't immediately look at chemical weapons. The defeat happens in 73, and that it's not a coincidence that when you look back through what is on the public record, that both the Syrian and the Iraqi programs appear to start roughly 1973. I think that the timeline is quite good. There does appear to be some expansion after the invasion of Lebanon by Israel in 82, where the Syrians start getting a sense they need to do more. And in fact, that's the first time that rumours start coming out of Israel. And it appears that actually the Syrians were telling the Israelis at the time, this is what our capability is. And of course, if you think about any basic deterrent theory, if you're going to use chemical weapons as a deterrent, you've got to let the other side know you've got them. There's no point having it completely hidden. And because of that nature of why it's looking into chemical weapons, it is primarily focused on weapons delivered by air to be able to put chemical materials onto population centres within Israel. Because that's what has, in the Syrian view, a deterrent effect. And there's very little indication, looking through the historical record, of any kind of tactical weapon, which is what is alleged to have been used in Damascus in 2013. Some discussion of ground-launched weapons in terms of medium-range scuds, but nothing short-range. So one of the dates we have, before we go into misleading narratives, but one of the dates we have with some certainty? Well, in March 2011 is the start of the anti-government protests. Many reports at that time of tear gas use, particularly at funerals of protesters. And what is interesting is governments that have ended up using chemical weapons against civilian targets, and often again, also against other armies, have often had an initial use of tear gas. There seems something psychologically in the human process of deciding command that tear gas gets used before lethal chemicals. In July 2012, Makdassi, who was the Syrian foreign minister, made a set of comments about chemical and about weapons of mass destruction, saying that any chemical and biological weapons that would be in the possession of Syria would not be used against Syrians. And this was taken as an implicit admission that they had chemical weapons. This, of course, generated a certain amount of press discussion, and the red line comments that Obama had about the movement or use of chemical weapons occurred at a press conference, which actually you can see that if you go through the sequence of events, really follows from what had been said the month before by Mukdasi about chemical weapons in Syria. I mean, there are other influences as well. The internal conflict continued within Syria. There was a particular incident on the 19th of March where both sides felt there was evidence, or indicated they felt evidence of the others using chemical weapons. So the Syrians on the 20th and the UK and France on the 21st of March presented formal allegations of chemical weapons use to the UN Secretary General, asking them to be investigated. There was a long process on this, and it wasn't until the 18th of August that year that a team headed by Åke Sällström of Sweden was actually able to arrive in Damascus, because there'd been a whole set of arguments about modalities of operation. Then, of course, on the 21st of August, as will be discussed by Caitriona, the Pipanese Gutar were clearly affected by a toxic agent, something that affected their nervous system. This prompted international outrage. Led the Kerry-Lavrov agreement. Syria deposited its ratification to the Chemical Weapons Convention, becoming a party exactly 1 month later. And 2 days after that, there was the initial Sällström report published, which didn't give any attribution. It simply said, we're confident that there was material used. Part of that through analysis of samples taken from people. There was the identification of sarin, because sarin within the human body breaks down into isopropyl methylphosphonic acid, IMPA, and that is very distinctive. You don't get it within your body unless you've been exposed to sarin. There's very little else it could be mixed up with at all. On the 27th of September, there was the formal putting into international law of the Kerry-Lavrov Agreement. In a decision taken in the OPCW and the UN Security Council Resolution 2118. Just as a quirk, those who follow diplomatic processes have never seen meetings stopping the clock. The adoption of that OPCW decision, the clock was stopped even before the meeting started, because they didn't adopt the decision until after midnight, and they realised there was going to be a bit of a difficulty because everybody was waiting in New York to adopt the Security Council Resolution, which would mention the OPCW decision specifically. And the difficulty would be if the OPCW decision was formally adopted on the 28th, the UN Security Council would have to say it commended the OPCW decision taken a day later, because it was still before midnight. So even though the OPCW decision was taken at about 1 o'clock in the morning, it was still legally considered to be the 27th. On the 13th of December, the final Sällström report was published, which gave more detail and looked into other allegations, but again did not attribute anything. And then on the 23rd of June, the last declared materials were removed from Syria. There's much more to that story, but I'll leave those dates as significant. Katrina.
Thank you. So what I'm going to be talking about comes from a project that I'm involved in with colleagues from the Harvard Sussex program, James Revel, who sat here, and Julian Perry Robinson, and also colleagues from Cranfield University, that's capturing data on Syrian chemical weapons allegations, and it's being funded by the Economic and Social Research Council. And from the start, I particularly want to give much credit for the work for James Revel, because what he's been trying to do is sift through an extremely complex information environment, which I'll demonstrate hopefully how complex it is, in order to try and bring some order to it for us to examine what's been happening. So the first thing to really say is that from the very outset of the Civil War, we can see that there were two dominant narratives that very quickly came to the fore, and these were either focusing in on the actions of the regime or focusing in on the actions of the opposition and their ties with jihadists. These were completely unrelated to chemical weapons, that's the first thing to say. And in both of these narratives, Ben Perath writes that whatever side you stood on, they very quickly started to turn to visually evocative narratives, to images of pain and suffering, in order to vilify their respective enemies. And alleging chemical weapons use or associating your enemy with chemical weapons use fits very easily into this particular pattern of behaviour. And as Julian Perry Robinson has previously written, that this is one of the strengths of chemical weapons and indeed of germ weapons. It might be weak on the battlefield, but it provokes very strong emotions. And so it's been used for centuries, for millennia even, he writes, by both the well-intended and also the unscrupulous to vilify your enemies. And there was many instances of allegations of chemical weapons use prior to Guthrie, indeed after Guthrie, where emotion could be provoked. This is the list of allegations which the United Nations was tasked to examine in their original investigation. And the purpose is really to put Guthrie within this broader context of chemical weapons allegations. And it's important to remember that those in blue included allegations of government use of chemical weapons, regime use, but also opposition use of chemical weapons. And they slotted these allegations very easily into the two dominant narratives. For countries such as France, the UK, the United States, chemical weapons use by the regime, they believed, would only be a very short matter of time before it started going towards lethal use, lethal agents. But for countries like Syria and the Russian Federation and Iran, etc., the allegations of regime use were dismissed. They were considered to be baseless. And you very much had the idea that they, you know, these were weapons that had fallen into militant hands, this was weapon use. But there was something, I think, different about Guthrie that we can all easily say. So what I'm going to do over the next couple of slides is to present to you some of the initial graphs that we're generating using data which we're getting from a company that we're working with who gathers together social media data. There's some limitations to the data and therefore to the graphs, which I need to say up front. The first is that we're having to use predefined categories that the company has set. And we can't do anything about that. They define what goes into each of the categories. The second sense in which it's preliminary is that there is a bias within what platforms they access towards the English language. So for example, the company does not gather data on the Russian version of Facebook, VK. So that's another limitation to think of. And they're preliminary in the sense that we haven't yet included platforms such as YouTube, which was certainly most popular at the time for uploading videos, nor indeed Twitter, that's what we're doing at the minute. So what you're going to be seeing is graphs that show data from the categories that this company has defined as news, forums, discussion forums, and blog postings. They're also initial in that we haven't set these in their context. We're yet to include a line about the general traffic of social media about the Syrian civil war during the periods that we're covering. So with those caveats in mind, and I hope that they will make sense. This first graph, and perhaps if I dim the lights a little bit. Hopefully you'll see the colours a little bit more. This first graph shows the mentions of Syria and chemical weapons or chemical attack between the dates of late May 2013 and late May 2015. And what we can see is that there are spikes here which correspond to previous chemical weapons allegations. And then what we see here, August 21st, is a step change in the mentions. An enormous level of activity mentioning these three terms, which occurs over a relatively short period of time. And this corresponds to what we instinctively know, that there was something different about Guta when you compare it to other chemical weapons allegations. And here I just want to say that within the Civil War, social media is being used not to broadcast information, but also to rebroadcast information. So within hours of the attack in Guta here, this is the spike for Guta there, we're told that hundreds of original videos started to be uploaded onto YouTube. And these were produced by citizens, citizens with their mobile phones, and that fits in the general pattern of citizen journalists within the Civil War period. A portion of these contributions were then rebroadcast, either by television stations or by news media, whether that be online news media or traditional broadsheet news media. But the platforms that have been chosen, the social media platforms that have been chosen to broadcast the original information, means that you, I, anybody can go back to these original raw footages and see them for ourselves. And so that's an important thing to remember. This graph is interesting in itself, but what I find interesting is if you zoom in on this area of activity to see what's going on. And here is a graph that starts at the beginning of the UN investigation and finishes at the final report being submitted. And we see a slightly different picture from the original graph. The first thing that we see is for sure we have spikes here. This is the spike for August 21st. But the majority of the activity is actually occurring afterwards, and it's occurring over a month period. And our spikes of activity are actually coming on August 28th and September 10th. Even more interesting for people like me who follow chemical weapons issues, chemical weapons convention issues, is what happens when we overlay this graph with things that we think are important milestones in the story, the confident dates that Richard has just been talking about. And what we see is this. The activity doesn't correlate to what it is that we believe is the important milestones in the Syria project. In fact, it appears from the data that we're using that the how are we going to resolve this issue, which is in the tail end of the graph, isn't really gaining much traction at all amongst the platforms that we're using. What's gaining the traction is the what happened and what might happen in the immediate future. So if we consider the two largest peaks here, August 28th and this one, September 10th, what they're corresponding to in the real world is a UK proposal to the P5, it's a draft resolution, to authorise military action to protect civilians. And then on September 10th, our biggest peak is Obama telling Congress to delay its vote. So that for me is really, really quite a startling graph when you overlay. So if what's been gaining traction is the what's happening, what might happen, then we started to go into what was actually being said, to start to go into the data. And whilst most of the media attention and the social media attention is coalescing around the two dominant narratives which pre-existed the Guta attacks, what we start to see is that there's several other narratives which start to emerge around these central themes. And a review of the documents we've collected show that there's at least 9 of them, at least, 7 of which try and attribute responsibility. And for the convenience, we've been grouping them under 3 headings: the nothing happened, it was the regime, no it wasn't, it was non-regime groups. I'm not going to go through all 9, but I wanted to show some of the complexity of the information environment to just illustrate some of them. So starting with the nothing happened narrative, this really began immediately on the day. And as you can imagine, we have a lot of it coming out of Syria on the day. So we have the Syrian information minister, who is our first quote here, saying that it's, you know, the pictures are fabricated. You know, we don't know what's going on. And this is picked up by the Syrian state news agency, Sana, and it's broadcast out. They too say it's a fabrication, and they suggest that it's an Israeli deception. The Russian foreign ministry also starts to pick up on this narrative a few days later, suggesting that it was a staged event. But by far, and sorry, that's the last of the quotes there. But by far, the person most closely associated with this narrative is Mother Agnes. The report that she helped to write for ICE themes. And in this report, indeed it's Mother Agnes's position, is that the attacks, she said, were stage managed, and they actually involved children who had been kidnapped and drugged 2 weeks prior in northern Latakia. Yes, I think that's how you pronounce it. Latakia. Now this narrative and the work of Mother Agnes, the work of ICEMS, is largely dismissed within Western governments and within Western commentators. But elsewhere it gains an awful lot of traction. And it's particularly used by both the Russian government and Russian media. But over the coming months, what we see is that we have similar types of stories that this is a staged event emerging. And some of the individuals who claim this are, for example, George Galloway. We have former UK Ambassador Craig Murray. And we have media channels such as Mint Press, who charged the BBC with a stunning bit of fakery in one report where they changed the word napalm to chemical weapons in their translation of an interview with a local doctor. Now within the collection of narratives under regime use, the one that we're most familiar with, I think, in the UK, is the idea that it was the responsibility of President Assad, he commanded it. These allegations began, again, on the very day, and they gathered momentum over time, and they come from a range of sources on the day, including opposition leaders, which is the first quote here, but also in multiple press sources. Following an initial spell of caution, we start to see Western governments picking up on this narrative as well, and that's illustrated by William Hague here in the second quote, but you can also find it in a range of other government statements. And towards the end of August, we start to get the release of government intelligence assessments on what it was that they believe happened. And they do so with varying degrees of certainty. And this is a critical thing to remember when you're thinking about the information environment. Note, for example, the use of language between the JIC assessment, the UK's assessment, and the US's assessment. In the UK assessment, it's suggest. And in the US assessment, it's high confidence. It's a small difference in language, but therein lies an uncomfortable truth for us. Because no matter how popular this narrative is, there are problems with it in how it's presented within open sources, including there is no smoking gun that links President Assad with the chemical weapons attacks. Nor is there a sufficient answer to why it was at that particular date he used chemical weapons at that scale. That hasn't been answered satisfactorily. And so it creates confusion, it creates doubt, it creates a space for narratives to exist. A variation on the regime use is that it wasn't President Assad, it was actually his brother who was directly responsible for it. And this report starts to appear, or this narrative starts to appear a few days after the attacks, and it starts from an Israeli media outlet. And that the report that they do is then rebroadcast on several other countries and in several other media formats. And in part, this narrative is being fed by the ambiguity within the intelligence reports. The suggestion that it is in fact the brother rather than President Assad took a very interesting twist in early September, because what began to emerge was this Bilan Sontag article, which was quoting the German intelligence intercepts. And this was rebroadcast, and here we see a quote from the Bilan Sontag article. And the second spike of interest happened later on in 2014, and it was an interview which appeared in CBRNE World with Åke Sällström, the chief UN weapons inspector in Syria, where he says, was it the opposition sent him to a message to the world or the president's brother? And whilst you can dismiss certain other sources, it becomes quite hard to dismiss words from Åke Sällström. But ultimately this one ran out of steam, I do have to say. The final regime narrative that I wanted to bring up was this one that it wasn't actually calculated to be the scale that it was, and I include it because of its reliance on unnamed sources. And this is usually a flag for people who look into allegations. You know, why aren't people naming themselves? Why aren't they standing up? Unnamed sources is just a little flag, but nevertheless, this gained traction. The first here, the Israeli official, saying it was an operational mistake, was reprinted in the New York Times, and it was circulated from there. And then this report of a report from German intelligence started off in Der Spiegel, and then started on to Russia Today, and then went on from there. So moving on to the non-regime uses, so the ones which focus in on the opposition movement. There is, again, many clusters of them, but I just want to highlight a few. This one particularly resonated because the seeds of it were planted before the Guthrie attacks, with the allegations that opposition had used chemical weapons. Mm-hmm. And beginning on the day of the attack, August 23rd, you get a deluge of suggestions that it was in fact the rebels who had used it, appearing alongside the questions and the queries about why on earth would the regime use it at that scale, at that moment. They come hand in hand. And they are, as you can expect, most closely associated with Syria and its allies, including Iran, the foreign minister here, and indeed President Putin when he wrote his op-ed in the New York Times in mid-September. And this sub-narrative really gained weight because of reports in the two weeks that were following the attacks about, for example, chemical agents being found in rebel or formerly rebel-held tunnels. And also that Turkey was indicting some of the rebels. And closely associated with this one is the idea that it wasn't just them on their own, they actually had foreign intelligence support. And as you can again imagine, this gained great salience within Syria, within Iran, but also within Western countries. And these are quotes from two people within the US, amongst other places where it gained quotes. The first, Yosef Budansky, is a very interesting character. And he starts to write this piece about how there's a growing volume of new evidence which is coming out, which is providing a very strong case, he says, albeit based on solid circumstantial evidence, he writes in his article. that these were premeditated provocation by the rebels. And he says that on August 13th to 14th, we had these initial meetings between Qatari, Turkish and US intelligence with the FSA to plan all of this out. And this is repeated and repeated. And you have a similar story coming up from Kenneth Timmerman, amongst others, a very similar story. This time he quotes, in particular, an Egyptian intelligence report, which says so. So those are the narratives that I wanted just to highlight to you. And I wanted to give you an idea of how these are circulated within social media, what sort of traction they did actually get. And despite the caveats that I presented to you before about the limitations on the data, etc., as crude as this is, what you see is that in the top six articles of each of the narrative variations that I presented, when it's shared on Twitter and on Facebook, you see astounding numbers, as far as I'm concerned. I've combined the three regime did it narratives together, and I wanted to see how it is that they stacked up against single, no it wasn't, narratives. And it's extraordinary. Deliberate non-regime use compared to the combined Facebook likes of the three, it was the regime. And that shows you the sorts of, or gives you an illustration of the sorts of traction within social media, within the world of social media, that these narratives are getting. And I think, like it or not, these other narratives are having salience with certain sections of the population, and what we might think as being the dominant narrative, that it was President Assad who did it, this is what our UK government tells us, doesn't actually look all that dominant when you stack it up in these figures. Only a few of the competing narratives we can now very confidently dismiss. The nothing happened one, for example. But for the rest of them, there is evidence out there, there still remains evidence out there that can be used to support them. And often it's the same pieces of evidence, the same documents, the same films, the same sources, which are being used in the multiple narratives. And the difference being your interpretation of them according to your political viewpoints and your world views. So despite being party to the title of this seminar, I'm not entirely sure that misleading is really quite the right word to be using about misleading narratives. So you could argue that what these, albeit initial analysis of social media traction, which I've presented today, is just a sign of the nature of social media itself. That is a channel of communication which is more conducive to conspiracy theories than to truth. And perhaps that's so. Perhaps simply the narrative of the regime did it is too dull. Dull doesn't mean bad. Dull just means dull. It doesn't gain traction. Perhaps that's the reason. And in general, you know, we're seeing that once political decisions were made, like, are we going to go to war? Is there going to be invasion? We've got a big tail off of interest within the story. And perhaps that says something about the news cycle in general, the broadsheet news cycle, the 24-hour news cycle that we now demand, the news cycle within social media. Perhaps it also suggests to us that the solving of the issue problem, the work of the investigation, the work of destroying it, wasn't communicated in a way which grabbed attention. Perhaps it was too slow, it was too technical. It just didn't gain any form of traction. And perhaps another way of seeing it is that for the first time in CBW, chemical biological warfare allegation history, it's not governments that are controlling the information. It's the nature of the information that's being spread and also the speed at which that information is being spread. And the true power of social media, which this shows here, isn't necessarily what's been said, but it's how far it's been, how far it's reaching. It's the reach which is the power. And that's why we're including it. And if we, I think, again, those who look into allegation work, if we accept that data streams are going to be poisoned by error, by misinformation, by disinformation, by spin, then what social media does is act as a complete megaphone for that. So by not having, this is the power. The truth almost doesn't matter. It's the impression that's given out. So by not having a definitive answer, a quick definitive answer about what happened on August 21st, about who was responsible for it, a space was created in which these alternative narratives could break down and could gain traction. And at the best, it leaves those of us who are interested in this to major cognitive overload. It's tremendously complicated to sift through and to deal with all of these narratives. So for the general public, for everyone who uses social media, the cognitive overload is going to be that step above, and with cognitive overload comes disinterestedness. It's just too complicated to figure it out. And what we can perhaps suggest on this graph, which now Richard is going to talk about, is the longer the story of chemical weapons allegations, chemical weapons use continues in Syria without any resolution, the consequence is this tail end, is that people are simply becoming disinterested in the story. And it's on this that Richard is now going to finish up with.
Thank you very much. Yes, it's that graph showed how the sort of trickle of interest in things, but actually there's a lot going on. Now, in starting to look at what the ongoing issues are, we need just to think about something of what's happened. What happened within Syria was the first time a chemical weapons program was actually dismantled within a country that was at war or in a conflict situation. And so we've got some issues remaining which I'm not going to deal with here, but we can deal with in question and answers if people want, which is regarding the destruction of production facilities. Some of these are in areas that are not under government control anymore, so there's some difficulty. But some of the ongoing issues, we do need to put things into context. I mean, one of the great problems of trying to get any attribution is there is bigger politics going on. It was quite remarkable in terms of dealing with the Russian government, that in the first months after what had happened in August 2013, the Russians were interacting very actively in The Hague and elsewhere on the subject. Then the crisis in the Crimea happened, and you had all the issues over Ukraine, and that made a lot of interactions much more difficult. You know, high-level meetings no longer had Syria was 75% of the time within the program of work, suddenly it was only a few percent. I mean, there's some really big, big power issues. And they made attribution very, very difficult, or even compilation of evidence that might look at attribution. But as Caitriona said, part of the problem is a lot of the physical evidence you might find on the ground might have more than one meaning. I mean, if we take what I feel as the two most likely scenarios. One is the government did it, the second the opposition did it, tried to make it look like the government did it, which I think are the two most likely scenarios. The physical evidence you would find on the ground would be very similar for both. So there's that difficulty. The other sorts of attribution are also difficult. People have looked at doing conventional criminal investigation techniques, but of course in a country in conflict, that's very difficult. And also, the nature of the opposition groups can be very fluid. Most people within opposition groups have previously been involved with the government. And some people are acting, it seems, in favour of the opposition while still wearing government uniforms, and some members of the opposition have, in a sense, moved back towards the government. So defining whether any individual was acting under the control of any other political entity can be recognized. But this lack of attribution reduces chances of reaching any kind of accountability, let alone justice. But there is more going on at the moment. And the significant thing is about the chlorine allegations, which in some ways have a much more pervasive and subtle undermining of the international norm against chemical weapons. Although there were some suggestions of chlorine use very early on in the conflict, before the use of sarin in August 2013, there's actually been a very interesting, consistent pattern of chlorine allegations since early 2014. This involves helicopters flying overhead, dropping barrel bombs that contain chlorine. Now, the first thing that's worth noting is nobody has produced any evidence of opposition groups having access to helicopters. And that in itself there are plenty of people who are looking for any evidence that opposition groups have had access to helicopters, because of course that's a very important piece of information. There was a fact-finding mission agreed to go to Syria, under the auspices of the Chemical Weapons Convention. The first fact-finding mission went out in May 2014. While they were entering the rebel-held area where the allegations of use had emanated from, where there'd been videotape of these barrel bombs, the team was attacked. The lead vehicle was essentially destroyed. It was made unusable by an improvised explosive device. And as they were driving back towards government lines, having gone through the procedure to evacuate everybody out of that vehicle, it then came under automatic gunfire. As you can imagine, the team then did not make a further attempt at that point to get into the area, but it was able to interview people who were able to get out of the rebel areas, either into Syrian government territory or to another country. And their conclusion, you can read the quote itself, but the credence to the view that toxic chemicals, most likely pulmonary irritating agents such as chlorine, have been used in a systematic manner in a number of attempts. There's also been another investigation, which I hadn't put in this because I was trying to check what had been made public, but in the report the OPCW published last week, that the next fact-finding mission has gone in and has come out successfully. There was a briefing last week in The Hague, two states parties, which will be made public later. I'm not trying to sound like it's cautious that I know anything about. I was at Glastonbury last week, so I had no chance to catch up with anything. So I didn't really want to rely on the latest report. But there seems to be credence to these allegations. And there's something very important in these. In the techniques being used